Xaden POV, Fourth Wing by Bell Beebe. Chapter 18. Accused. I should be shocked, but I'm not. Experience has taught me enough about the poison leeching its way through leadership, hidden behind rules we're told are here for our protection. No, it's not surprise that I feel after I leave Violet in her room. It's absolute resolve to fix this, to suck out the poison and make anyone involved in hurting her pay for what they've done. When I get back to my room, Garrick, Bodhi and Liam are already inside. All three of them sat around the small table in the corner. Liam doesn't look up when I enter, and I realize he's asleep, his blonde head propped on his arms on the table. I check the clock on the bedside table. It's almost 4 in the morning, but we're not done tonight. She okay? Garrick asks quietly. I want to tell them everything, the way I feel about her, how sure I am we can trust her, how much she could help us, not just because of who she is, but how she is. Instead, I nod, my lips tight. We've got work to do, I say, shaking Liam awake. Bodhi, speak to the others. Get the weapons out tonight. But Za, he challenges. I know, I say, my fingers pinching the bridge of my nose. It's not ideal, but if they leave now, they'll still land back here under cover of darkness, and I can create a distraction that will buy them enough time to return here before anyone notices that they're missing. We've got formation in the morning, Bodhi objects, but he's already getting to his feet, ready to follow orders, even if he doesn't agree. What kind of a distraction? Garrick presses, as I take a seat next to them round the table. A fucking big one, I say. It was Amber. Violet saw her. She let them in her room. What the fuck? Says Liam. Yeah, that'll do it, agrees Bodhi, heading to the door. I'll wake the others. You'll need proof, Xaden, says Garrick, bringing my attention back to him. Tell me you've got something beyond Sorengale's word. Something that's enough to accuse another wing leader of a capital offense. I shake my head. No, but I still can't let it stand. Garrick's face falls, and I see the huge risk I feel mirrored in his eyes. One wing leader accusing the other. It's never ended well. And it's unlikely to go much better for me given my family's glowing reputation. She was asleep. It's the one fucking place any of us should be safe, and she stole that from her. I've been waiting weeks for the unbonded to make their move, but I never even considered they'd have help from her. I can't say her name again. But it's your word against hers, Garrick counters. I can be pretty convincing when I want to be, brother. I reply smoothly, with a confidence I don't feel. Just have my back, so I can have hers. Liam looks between us warily, waiting for Garrick to nod his agreement. When he does, he asks me, what can I do? I need you to be where I can't. It doesn't take much to spread out the riders at formation to cover the spaces where Kieran and Soleil would usually stand. I send some to the archives on an invented urgent task. Another mysteriously slips on the stairs and is helped by 2 squadmates to Nolan. A handful more I order to clear out the dorms of the dead unbonded from last night. I create just enough disruption that no one questions the absence of 2 rebellion kids from their squads. The rest of the riders stand in formation, listening to Fitzgibbons read through the list of traitors I killed last night. The second he sends up the prayer to Malik, I move. Time to tackle the few outstanding items on my list. My gaze snaps to Violet as I head towards where she stands, straight-backed and beautiful. Her hair braided back with small wisps of silver-tipped strands, breaking free and blowing in the wind. I don't look at her neck, don't want to see the bruising around her throat and be reminded of how close I was to losing her. No. I need to put some distance back between us. Nothing can happen, no matter how much part of me wants to try. I could feel it last night. How easy it would be to let down all my walls and fight for her. But she has no idea how I feel about her, no idea where my mind wanders when I glance her way. This longing I feel for her is fucking selfish. It's everything I want, with no thought for what's best for her. The further she is from me, the safer she'll be. I snap at Etos, pouring the frustration I feel into the order. There's a change to your squad role. Wing leader? He snaps to attention. We just absorbed 4 from the dissolution of the 3rd squad. Yes. Shut up, Etos. Does he have to be such a know-it-all? I turn to address the squad leader of Tail Section. Belden, we're making a role change. Yes, sir. Belden nods. See, Etos. That's how to do it. Etos, Vaughn Penley will be leaving your command, and you'll be gaining Liam Mary from Tail Section. I dare him to argue, but he keeps his mouth tightly shut, nodding. Much better. Liam and I exchange a glance as he trades places, my eyes flicking for just a second towards Etos. He nods in understanding, remembering my orders from this morning. Under no circumstances should Etos put his hands on Violet. Do what you have to do. Her memories from last night stay her own. Violet's face is frozen in fury. She bites out at me. I do not need a bodyguard. I ignore her, addressing Etos. Liam is statistically the strongest first year in the quadrant. He has the fastest time up the gauntlet, hasn't lost a single challenge, and is bonded to an exceptionally strong red dagger tail. My heart fills with pride as I list through his achievements. Any squad would be lucky to have him, and he's all yours, Etos. You can thank me when you win the squad battle in the spring. I do not need a bodyguard. Violet repeats, her body thrumming with rage. She says it so loudly half the formation hears her. The challenge in her eyes makes my stomach flip. She is just incredible. I stride past Etos and stand right in front of her, towering over her to remind her I am much more equipped to defend her than she is herself. You do, though, as we both learned last night. I say it firmly, not caring who hears. They'll all know in minutes anyway. And I can't be everywhere you are. But Liam here, I gesture to Liam over her shoulder, who smirks at me. He's a first year, so he can be in every class, at every challenge, and I even had him assigned to library duty, so I hope you get used to him, Sorengale. I bite out her surname, doing my best to reinforce the reporting lines and achieve even the tiniest bit of authority in her presence. You've overstepping, she snaps back at me. You haven't begun to see overstepping, I shoot back, wondering if there's any limit to what I would do to keep her safe. Any threat against you is a threat against me, and as we've already established, I have more important things to do than sleep on your floor. Something like hatred flares in her eyes. He is not sleeping in my room. Of course not, I smirk, enjoying the way her cheeks blush at the idea of it. I had him moved into the one next to yours. Wouldn't want to overstep. I watch that parting shot land and storm back to position at the front of the lines, preparing myself for the much bigger fight that's coming next. Still, I can't help myself when I reach out with my shadows, checking on the fallout of the confrontation. Liam stares straight ahead, eyes forward, but I know he's following the interaction between Etos and Violet just the same. The riders closer to them are blatantly staring, as Etos demands. Is that what Riason meant by last night? Violet nods, dipping her head as if she can hide the deep purple bruise around her neck. I didn't know, he says. Why didn't you tell me?
Why?
What would you do about it, Etos? It certainly would have taken you longer to kill 6 people just to save her. Better consult the Codex first and check it's within the rules. Seeing him look at her, his eyes strained with concern and affection makes jealousy twist sharp and painfully in my gut. I'm fine, Violet says. Later. She nods towards the dais, and it forces my attention back to Commandant Panchek. I'm nervous. Really fucking nervous. It has been brought to my attention as your commandant that a breach of the Codex has occurred, Panchek says to the crowd. As you know, breaches of our most sacred laws are not to be tolerated. This matter will be addressed here and now. Will the accuser please step forward? I take a deep breath and go to take a step, but I can't move. Instead, an image of my father flashes through my mind. In that instant, I am overwhelmed by the bravery he needed to accuse the leaders of Navarre of their treachery. My heart is pounding in my chest as I force myself slowly towards the steps that lead to the dais, like I'm walking in his ill-fated footsteps, feeling the gaze of every rider burning on my back. Well, not everyone. I can still hear Violet across the quadrant, teasing Rydock about his latest encounter. She seems completely unaware of the sacrifice I am making to ensure she's safe. Instead of being annoyed, it makes me smile. Even after everything she went through last night, she feels safe. I did that. I almost trip when my shadows hear her say, "I miss sex," with a heavy, lust-filled sigh. It's exactly the distraction I needed to push me up the stairs towards the dais. "I miss good sex," she teases Rydock. Oh, violence, I would be all too willing to oblige. "What happened to keeping a professional distance, wing leader?" Scale's teasing voice dances through my mind. I smile, recognizing it for what it is. Another distraction to keep me going, to get me in front of the podium and make an accusation that once spoken, I can't take back. I look out at the grids of riders standing in straight, uniform lines. It feels prophetic ahead of the chaos I know is about to rip out around us. I take a deep breath. Early this morning, a rider in my wing was brutally, illegally attacked in her sleep with the intent of murder by a group primarily composed of unbonded cadets. I try to look anywhere but her, and yet my gaze still picks her out. Violet stares at me, a frown between her eyes. "As we all know, this is a violation of Article 3, Section 2 of the Dragon Riders Codex, and, in addition to being dishonorable, is a capital offense." My knuckles are white where they grip the podium stand hard, though my voice betrays nothing of the fear I feel. I can't tell if my heart is pounding, reliving last night's events, or out of fear for the consequences if this doesn't go my way. Having been alerted by my dragon, I interrupted the attack along with two other fourth wing riders. Garrick and Bodhi climb the steps towards me. As it was a matter of life and death, I personally executed six of the would-be murderers, as witnessed by Flame Section leader Garrick Tavis and Tail Section Executive Officer Bodhi Duran. They stand at my back, the crowd murmuring. But the attack was orchestrated by a rider who fled before I arrived. I project my voice louder, using the tiniest bit of the power I channel from Skyle to make it ring out across the quadrant. A rider who had access to the map of where all first years are assigned to sleep, and that rider must be brought to swift justice. It feels as if every rider leans toward me to hear what I say next. "I call you to answer for your crime against Cadet Sorengale." I finally take my eyes from Violet and look at Amber for the first time since I started speaking. "Wing leader Amber Mavis." A cacophony of voices breaks out, the disbelief spreading like waves across the formation. "You did great," Skyle reassures. "She must be made to pay." Amber steps forward, no emotion in her eyes. She can play this game as well as me, if not better. She's always been careful to keep her loyalties to Navarre perfectly clear. "I have committed no such crime," she says it evenly, pitched just right with a tinge of innocence and surprise. The voices around the quadrant get louder, faces whipping left and right between Violet, Amber, and me. I risk a glance at Violet and see her stepping back from Etos's outstretched hands. "Give me the memory," he orders. Liam has silently moved out of formation in the chaos, inching closer to Violet, ready to step between them if necessary. Imogen watches them quietly too, two rows back, but she doesn't need a bodyguard. "Touch me without permission, and you'll spend the rest of your life regretting it." Her voice is viciously quiet. I feel a secret thrill deep in my chest that she's never once turned that tone on me. "Wing leaders," I say. "We need a quorum." Naira and Septon climb the stairs, and we turn our backs on the formation, standing in a half circle. This is the moment that matters most. They must believe me over Amber, a marked traitor's son over a rule-abiding liar. I feel the beat of Skyle's wings as her and Tern land on the walls of the citadel alongside the other wing leader's dragons. I assume you have proof, Rierson? Septon asks. He raises an eyebrow at me with a look that says he knows I don't. Cadet Sorengale saw her with her own eyes. Mavis was in her room with the unbonded cadets that tried to kill her. She let them in. I say simply, with a shrug. That's not proof, Septon replies. That's hearsay. How else did 6 unbonded cadets get through a locked door? Only a handful of us know who sleeps where. Even fewer have access to the keys. That doesn't mean she did it, Rierson, Nyra snaps. Just because she had means, it doesn't equal that she had cause. Why would Amber want the first year dead? The use of her first name startles me. I'm Rierson here, and she's Amber. Not a great start. I don't care what her motive was, I fire back. Skyle lets out a blast of hot air over my head that makes the other wing leaders stiffen, but I know it's really meant as a warning to me. Calm down. She had means and Cadet Sorengale is an eyewitness. What possible reason would I have to accuse her if it weren't the truth? Suddenly Amber shouts from the crowd. You're using this to get your revenge on my family, for not supporting your father's rebellion. It's too conveniently timed to be a coincidence. Skyle whips her tail at Clade on the perch behind us, who snaps back with her teeth. I ignore the accusation, keeping my back to Amber. Nyra raises her eyebrows questioningly, letting the pause drag out long enough that I'm forced to fill it. I am simply defending a rider in my wing. Surely the evidence of last night's attack in her locked bedroom is all the proof you need, Septon shakes his head, a sick little smile already spreading across his face. Sadly not Rierson. He's enjoying this, the bastard. The only person who's admitting to murder here today is you. Suddenly Violet's memory fills my head. Tern, I think. Don't do this. It's such a violation, exposing her memory to us all. It was her request, Wingleader. I see Amber in Violet's room, the chain of keys in her hand. She's staring at me, no, at Violet, with a hateful smile, before she turns and locks the door behind her, leaving the 6 unbonded cadets in her room. I feel Violet's fear pounding through me like it's my own. There's no refuting evidence like this. Nyra looks at Septon, and he nods his agreement, waving me forwards towards the podium to deliver the verdict. The wing leaders have formed a quorum and are in unanimous agreement, I say to the crowd. We find you guilty, Amber Mavis. I look straight at her, turning that same hateful smile from Violet's memory on her. No, it is no crime to rid the quadrant of the weakest rider. I did it to protect the integrity of the wings. She's pacing like a caged animal, her eyes pinballing round the crowd. In a deafening motion, the formation moves back, leaving her exposed. As is our law, your sentence will be carried out by fire, Nyra states, no emotion in her voice. No! Amber panics, looking out towards her dragon like he can save her. Clade! This is hard to watch, harder than the traitors I killed so quickly last night. I've known Amber for years. She's a tire like me. I make myself look at her, giving her some respect in death. Please don't, I hear Violet beg. I stare at her, wanting to go to her. I know she will feel like this is her fault. Know she'll feel guilty for telling me, only for me to mete out this punishment on her behalf. I picture my shadows reaching out, stroking her cheek and taking the guilt away, carrying it back to me and tucking it in my jacket pocket. This is my doing, not hers. I can take it. Please give her a chance, her voice chokes on the words as she stares back at me across the formation. But I won't. This is no place for second chances. Here we get one chance, live or die. And Amber deserves to die for what she did. Amber whispers once more for her dragon, and I watch as Tern incinerates her before I can take another breath. Clade's scream rends through the air, and I cover my ears, feeling that scream tear through me. But then I think of the bruise on Violet's neck, the sheer terror in her eyes when she stood trapped under Seifert's knife. Justice, Scale growls low. Justice, I agree. Chapter 19, Safe. It's almost dawn the following morning when I hear a tentative tap on my bedroom door. Soleil looks like shit as I gesture her inside, closing the door behind her. Her eyes are bloodshot from lack of sleep and heavy dark shadows sink into her cheeks. She's never been particularly comfortable in my presence, but this morning her hands are trembling at her side. What happened? Fear pulses hot and thick through my veins. Niall's dead. It's barely a whisper. Sirena's... someone. I don't even know who he was to her. But I remember how she looked at him in the clearing, like he was the only one giving her the hope to carry on. My jaw clenches, and I gesture for Soleil to sit down. How? It was just after we met them. We were already on our way back to Basgiath when the dragons heard it from the griffins. They were spotted by a patrol near Sumaton. Did they find the weapons? I'm sickened with myself that the first thought is whether we're all safe. The flyers are already suffering all the losses in this war, surrounded by enemies on both sides, and all I can think is whether the people I care about will make it. Soleil shakes her head. Dragonfire. I swallow through the lump in my throat. There will be no evidence left after that. Sirena managed to get away when the rest of her drift arrived. She looks like she's close to tears. I'm sorry, Xaden. We should have gone back. I cut her off. No, it's not your job to protect them. She stares up at me with hollow eyes like she doesn't believe it. Then she reaches into her inner jacket pocket and stands up, handing me an envelope. Sirena gave me this for you. Brennan's scrawl is recognizable even in the near darkness. Soleil gives me a tight-lipped smile and heads toward the door. Soleil, I say, and she turns back to look at me, her eyes still haunted. Go see Imogen before you head to bed. She opens her mouth to argue, but I cut her off. If she gives you any shit, tell her I sent you. It's safer for all of us not to remember the specifics. And at least this way, maybe she'll get a few hours sleep without thinking about what else she could have done. The second she leaves, I rip open the envelope, but the letter is coded. Without Bodhi, it takes me almost an hour to decipher it. I try to focus on each individual letter as I work through it, not wanting to read the words until I can see the complete sentences, but some pull at me anyway. Trust. Safe. Important. Each one adds a new weight to my chest, the burden of her survival feeling heavier with every letter. It's not just me that needs her to survive this. It's Brennan. Xaden. Trust her like you would trust Liam. She has only ever tried to do what is right. Her bonds were always to our father and sister, not command. We can trust her. The news of her two dragons reached us here. It feels right that Tern has chosen her. She is the only person I can imagine worthy of sitting in the place where Naolin once did. You must keep her safe, Xaden. I know this is a lot to ask, that you already do too much with too little. But she matters. I can't shake the feeling that she is more important than any of us yet realize. Keep her alive, whatever it takes. I trust you. B. I can almost feel the fear in his words as he wrote them, and that's without the knowledge of the attack just last night in her room. My heart pounds in my chest. There's still 30 unbonded cadets, plus Barlow and everyone else who would like to see her or me dead. Suddenly, just having Liam next door to her doesn't feel like enough. I light the candle on the desk, watching the letter catch in one corner and burn across the page. Feel the heat lick into my fingers until it's almost unbearable before I drop it in the tray. I head to the first year rooms before breakfast, knowing that Liam and Violet will already be on their way to the archives. It takes me less than a minute toward her door, keying it so that only she can enter. And you, of course, says Scale. It's my magic. Of course I can enter. I snap back at her, not sure what point she is trying to prove. Well, of course, wing leader, she says with a huff that sounds suspiciously like a laugh. I have no fucking idea what is funny about that. Each morning, the words of Brennan's letter replay over and over in my mind, taunting me that I'm not doing enough to protect her. But I can't let myself get any closer, knowing that the more I entangle our lives, the greater the risk that she doesn't make it out of here alive. I've done what I can. The wards, Imogen, Liam, the rest is up to her. I managed to avoid seeing Violet for almost a week, finding someplace else to be during our only shared class each day. When Panchek asks for volunteers to run supplies to a Midland outpost, I almost knock over my chair with how quickly I agree, but I spend the whole flight there with only one person on my mind. I check in on Liam every evening, but he doesn't have much to report, and I can tell he's already getting bored of the frequency and subject of my visits. No, no one's tried to kill her. Yes, Atos is keeping his distance. No, she's not channeling. Eventually, I run out of plausible excuses to be anywhere but battle brief, and find myself filing into the room after every other rider. Somehow, my gaze still instantly finds Violet. Her beautiful, silvery plait knots around her head, sandwiched between Rhiannon's braids and Liam's dishevelled blonde locks. The second I take my seat, Liam turns round to look at me and leans over to say something to Violet. She holds up her middle finger to me, without even bothering to turn around to look. What a lovely response from the woman I'm doing everything within my power to protect. I glare at her, only to see Liam snort with laughter at my response. My foot taps in frustration. It takes all of 10 seconds for Garrick to reach out and grip my knee hard to force me to stop. Gods, this woman knows exactly how to get under my skin. Several rows back, my eyes catch on Barlow staring daggers at the back of Violet's head. His hand is gripping his quill so tightly I'm amazed it hasn't snapped. A girl I don't recognize leans to whisper something in his ear. My shadows strain to hear it but can't quite catch it. The sickening grin that spreads over Barlow's face sends a wave of unease over me. Don't mind her, she's just sexually frustrated. Makes a girl crabby. Rhiannon is so loud, most of the riders in the front few rows turn to look at them. The shadows slowly snake towards her of their own accord, pooling under the seats where Violet and Liam are sat. I'm sure Rearson would be fine with my reviewing a couple candidates, especially if it means you'll stop flipping him off in front of his entire wing, I hear Liam say. I sincerely doubt that, Skyle drawls. I ignore her along with the gnawing sensation in my stomach. Violet laughs, and my chest clenches at the sound. Thanks for the offer, though. I'll make sure to run any potential liaisons past you. Rhiannon says something, but I don't hear it, completely distracted by the sound of Violet's laugh. She has all her walls up with me. I don't think I've ever really heard it before. It's so free and weightless. It makes me want to smile despite myself. I'm just saying that since you're protected at night now, Liam says, but it makes them all laugh harder. Wait! Violet stops laughing. What do you mean I'm protected at night? Because you're next door. Please tell me he's not making you sleep in the hallway or something obnoxious. I already know from her tone that she's not going to like what he says. Should I have asked her first? Shit. No, of course not. He warded your door the morning after the attack. He pauses at whatever look he sees on her face. I'm guessing he didn't tell you. Obviously. I could punch him. He what? He warded your door, so only you can open it. I can't see her from the shadows around their feet, only able to pick up the sounds of their conversation. I have no idea how she reacts, no idea if she'll see it as me doing my part to protect her, or if this is just another example of me overstepping. My pulse races, imagining the expression on her face, if she were to turn and look at me. Distract me, I say to Garrick. What? His brow furrows in confusion, but then his gaze flicks to the front row. I don't know. Just tell me what formation you're planning for flight field later. His lips twitch, but he grabs a pen and starts drawing it out on a piece of paper between us and talking me through it. It's utter babble, but I force myself to nod, like I'm following every word. But my fucking shadows betray me anyway. Violet drops her quill, and before I can stop them, They gather it from the ground and rise up a couple of inches to hand it back to her. I stare resolutely at the paper on the desk, even when I can feel her gaze burning at me from across the room. Smooth, wing leader, Scale teases. Chapter 20, Heat and Fire. I manage to keep my shadows to myself for the rest of November. Day starts channeling to Liam about midway through the month, and Bodhi and I take turns teaching him to wield in his room. Violet's still not channeling, and I can't have Liam out of action for half the afternoon in Kar's class when she can't get in there yet. Garrick and I are already dripping with sweat as we enter the challenge room after a particularly grueling afternoon on the flight field. Panchek had us out in the skies for hours, repeating the same drills over and over until every rider was struggling to stay seated. To most, it was a ridiculous exercise, a test to stretch our capabilities in the air. But for the Rebellion kids, it was just another reminder of exactly what we stand to face beyond the borders. We were both silently seething the whole way back, so fucking angry at what Command is prepared to hide to save their own skin. So, when Garrick suggested a round of sparring, it felt like he was seeing inside my head. Now that I'm here, it feels like a decidedly bad idea when my eyes immediately pick out Violet, even in a throng of riders all gearing up for challenges to restart in a few weeks' time. Fuck. She looks incredible as she circles Rhiannon on the mat, giving me a view of her from every angle. Her cheeks are flushed pink with the exertion, but she looks so much stronger than she did a few months ago, the muscles in her arms flexing as she swings the weapon in her hands. Rhiannon has her training with a bow staff, but I can see from here that it's all wrong for her. That kind of weapon needs size and strength. It throws Violet's balance off with every strike. The words in Brennan's letter haunt me. Keep her alive, whatever it takes. In my selfish attempt at distance, I've left her training and protection in the hands of a first year. A first year who also has no idea of the extent of the threat we face. As if to prove my point, I watch from the doors as Rhiannon puts Violet on the mat and waits an extra beat before re-engaging. I'm walking towards them intending to teach her myself. When Violet says, "You're taking it easy on me." She glares up at Rhiannon, who grimaces back at her, swishing the staff through the air. "We've been at this for an hour. You're tired, and the last thing I want to do is hurt you." "Challenges resume after solstice," Violet says, as she gets back on her feet. "You're not doing me any favors by holding back." "She's not wrong," I say, unable to stop myself from reinforcing the point. I lock my eyes with Rhiannon pointedly, who drops her gaze to the floor. Liam jumps to his feet from where he was sat on the bench, like he's suddenly remembered he's supposed to be looking out for her too. Do these people not realize what's at stake here? I walk past them with Garrick before I can say something stupid. "Well aware," Violet says, tracking me with burning, angry eyes as I walk past her. She flicks her hand at me dismissively. "Go away, unless you have something useful to say." Gods, I love the way she talks to me, the fiery challenge in her eyes. She is so completely unafraid. I want her so fucking badly, I'm scared it's all over my face. I don't look back at her but call out, "Move faster, you'll be less likely to die. How's that for useful?" Garrick can barely contain a laugh as we reach the first empty mat in the center of the gym. "You can shut the fuck up too," I say, unbuttoning my flight jacket. We're not dressed for sparring, but I'm so tense with all this pent-up rage and frustration, I couldn't give a fuck who sees the scars today. But he's still struggling not to smile as he walks onto the mat. I throw my arm out to knock it right off his face, but he blocks it, anticipating the move, and grabs my wrist in two hands to twist my arm up in the air. This guy has never fought fair, even when we were younger. It's the only way he thinks he can win. We lock eyes and he wiggles his eyebrows at me, his eyes squinting as he grins. I twist round sharply, shifting his weight off balance and shove him away from me. We're a few paces apart, and the world narrows to the corners of this mat. It's the freest I've felt in weeks. "You good, brother?" Garrick says, watching me with careful eyes. I nod, tracking his movements as he shakes out his arms, shifting his stance a little. Let's go. He comes at me then, blow after blow. It takes every bit of concentration to block each hit, dipping under or leaning back sharply when I can't, so they sail right past me. All I can focus on is anticipating his next move, weeding through the feints to spot the hits he intends to land. It's brutal and unrelenting, and exactly what I need. There's no time to be afraid here. We find our rhythm, familiar patterns of moves mixed up to create new combinations. My breaths come hot and fast, another layer of sweat coating my skin and dripping down my back. We circle each other, both breathing heavily, and I see the exertion and adrenaline I feel mirrored back on his face. His eyes flick behind me, and he grins. Seems we've got a bit of an audience. But I've seen this trick before, and don't dare to turn around. So it's my shadows that look behind me, only to find nearly every rider in the gym watching us. Violet is tracking us with eyes that are all fire, her mouth parted slightly, her tongue dancing on the inside of her bottom lip. Gods, the things I want to do with...
Concentrate, wing leader!
Skyle's voice cuts through my thoughts. You know I don't like to lose. Garrick smirks at me across the mat, clearly aware of exactly where my thoughts have gone. Let's give them something worth watching, then, I say with a grin. I gesture him forwards again, and he kicks out low, trying to take my knees out from under me. I jump over it and swivel to face him, each hit coming at me more furiously than before. It's only when I hear Violet's back hit her own mat that Garrick manages to land a punch, hitting me so hard in the jaw that I feel it reverberate up to the top of my skull. Idiot fool, Scale seethes. But I can't help myself. I stop and glance towards her to check if she's okay. She's on the floor, the wind clearly knocked out of her as she struggles to take in a breath. Garrick sees it too, coming to stand at my side and toweling off like he needed the break. Rhiannon's on the ground next to her, but my jaw clenches as Barlow approaches to throw some insults at her, now that she doesn't have the air to fight back. Fucking coward. Liam is on his feet and standing between them before Barlow can manage a single step onto the mat. But the sadistic smile curling up on his mouth has me moving towards her before I can think better of it. Walk the fuck away, Barlow, Liam warns. I stand on the other side of Violet and cock my head. Barlow looks up at me and spits out, She's only alive because of you. I'm sure that's the lie he tells himself so he can sleep at night, when Violet could have killed him three times over. Right, because I'm the one who buried a dagger in your shoulder at threshing, I say, relishing the fear in his eyes as I picture all the ways I could kill him. Violet scrambles to her feet, grabbing hold of the bow staff so she's armed. Where the fuck are her daggers? And why the fuck isn't she wearing her vest? I spot it laid out on the bench where Liam was sat. What good is it going to do there? She's lucky that whatever hit put her on the mat didn't break her ribs. We could just settle this now, Barlow says to her, stepping to one side of Liam. If you're done hiding behind the big strong men. For a second, I wonder if she's going to be stupid enough to take the bait. But then I remember this is Violet he's talking to, and she's smart enough to ensure the next time she faces him will be on her terms. But gods, I would love to prove just what he's up against. I could kill him before he took a step. Liam could beat him even on a bad day. It warms my heart a little as I see Garrick and Imogen step in a bit closer, like they're prepared to stand between them too. I don't know if they're doing it for Violet or me, but it's a sweet little reminder that we're all on the same side. Barlow takes her silence as an admission of weakness, not proof of her smarts. That's what I thought, he says, blowing a kiss at her. You ran! She flings it at him like it's one of her daggers, her voice ringing out through the hall. That day in the field, you fucking ran when it was 3-on-1, and we both know when it comes down to it, you'll run again. That's what cowards do. I don't think she could have eviscerated him more if she'd kicked him in the balls. Barlow flushes as the sniggers break out around the gym. I feel a burst of pride in my chest. She's not wrong, I say, and Garrick laughs. Barlow goes to move onto the mat, and my shadow's tense, but Liam muscles him off and pushes him back towards the open door. I flick my hand sharply and swing the door shut with my power from across the room. What the hell were you thinking egging him on like that? Atos shouts, marching towards Violet. No, not happening. If anyone is meeting out discipline on this mat today, it's me. Oh, now you feel like talking to me? Violet seethes, turning to him, but I step in between them. She's coiled to strike, determined to lash out. Well, that makes two of us. Give us a second, I say to Etos and Rhiannon, without ever looking their way. My eyes are locked on Violet, tendrils of hair escaping from her braid, her skin flushed with exertion. I couldn't take my eyes off her if I wanted to. You want to tell me why the fuck you're not wearing that? I ask softly, but we both know it's loaded with tension as I point to her discarded leather vest, the only thing separating her from life and death on more than one occasion. I have to wash it at some point, she chimes back, sarcasm dripping from her voice. And you thought that would be a good idea during sparring? I don't even know what to do with her. It's like she's trying to get a rise from me. I'm burning up with emotions, half of me furious and desperate to get her to have some, hell, any, self-preservation. The other half wondering if she's doing all this just to get my attention. Either way, she has it completely. I washed it before sparring, knowing it could dry while your guard dog keeps watch, as opposed to sleeping without it, because we both know what happens behind locked doors around here. Her eyes burn into mine. Not behind yours anymore. I know. She knows. But I make sure anyway. There's nothing I won't do to keep you safe. I made sure of it. Because I'm supposed to trust you? Her tone is vicious, and it slices through me worse than if she'd cut me with one of her blades. I'm desperate for her to trust me, but there is still so much she doesn't know, that she can't know just yet. I swallow, and it physically pains me to simply say, yes. Nothing about this is simple, and you make it so easy. You know I can't kill you. What doesn't she understand about this? Fuck, Sorengale, the entire quadrant knows I can't kill you. I move closer to her, expecting her to back up, but she doesn't. She's never backed up, refuses to yield to anyone. Instead, I'm now a step closer than professional would dictate. That doesn't mean you can't hurt me, she whispers. I would never. After everything, how can she still? I blink and lean back a fraction, my brows furrowed. Why doesn't she know that I would do anything to keep her alive? Stop training with a bow staff. I try to make it sound like an order, a wing leader instructing a first year on basic sparring. But I'm so close to her, it comes out all wrong. It's kind and soft and sweet. It's too easy to knock out of your hands. Stick to the daggers. I make a mental note to send word back to Aricia and get some real weapons made for her, my pulse racing just imagining her holding two Tirish daggers in her hands. I was doing just fine until Tern barged into my head with all his anger and distracted me, she retorts, determined to turn this into an argument. Then learn how to block him out. What, with all this power I'm wielding? She's so furious at her own shortcomings. That's what this is about, I realize. Or were you unaware that I'm still not channeling? Gods, I love her like this. Fired up, passionate and determined not to budge an inch. The tension between us feels electric. I lean in, so close I can almost feel her hot, angry breaths against my lips. I am annoyingly aware of everything you do, I admit just to her. Wing leader Riorson, Etos interrupts, snapping me out of myself. She's just not used to the bond yet. She'll learn how to block it out. Remind me again why you moved this idiot into your wing, says Skyle. Pretty sure that was your idea. Keep your enemies close and all, I send back. I feel her huff out hot steam in a snort. That doesn't sound like me at all. I step back, but Violet's eyes have a heat in them that I've not seen before, and I can't go far. You choose the oddest times to defend her, Atos. I tear my eyes from Violet's to look at him. And the most convenient times not to. I watch the words land like a hook to his gut. Etos looks like he wants to punch me. I'm half-minded to let him, just for an excuse to put him on the ground in front of her. Instead, I turn back to Violet and say, "Do us both a favor and put the fucking armor back on." I stride off the mat before she can stop me, taking my shirt from Garrick's outstretched hand. Her gasp tells me she's seen the ugly mess of scars across my back. I tug the shirt over my head quickly and keep walking. I don't want her pity. That's the last thing I want from her. "Not tonight," I beg of Skyle. But there's no response, just yearning and fire. I've been laying fully dressed on my bed, staring at my ceiling for over an hour, replaying that parting look from Violet on the mat, the fire burning in her eyes that looked more like lust than anger. It's only when I'm walking towards her room without remembering how I got there that I put two and two together. This isn't me. It's them, Skyle and Tern. The second I'm fully aware of it, it becomes more intense. Even blocking them does little to take the edge off. Their antics are kindling for a fire that is already smouldering inside me. I need air. I've got to get out of here. I'm not even wearing a cloak, just a shirt and pants that shouldn't be enough against the cold, but I'm warmed by the fire that's raging through my veins. I head down the spiral staircase to the walls lining the citadel, patting my jacket pocket to feel for the rolled stick of churum I save for moments just like this. A burst of heat from Skyle burns through me, and I put an arm out to steady myself against the crumbling walls. Usually, I would go further into the trees, breathe in the scent of mulch and dirt and darkness. This will have to do. I light the churum and take a deep inhale, savoring the release of tension that comes with that familiar, sweet, smoky taste. I immediately feel more in control of myself. It's beautiful out here tonight, snow falling in soft clouds around me, melting into the gravel at my feet. I take another long drag, feeling the churum giving me some much-needed distance from the mated dragons. But with that mental clarity, my own thoughts quickly follow. Violet. I wonder if she's feeling this too, hoping she's still blissfully unaware of what Tern channeling to her will mean in moments like this. I think of her just hours earlier, furious with me on the mat, her eyes lit with rage and the edge of something much more interesting. For the first time, I wonder if the crackling tension between us isn't only in my head. I take another deep inhale, leaning my head back on the cold wall behind me, savoring the icy burn against my skin. I feel shadows shift on the same staircase that brought me here and realize I won't be alone much longer. It's Violet, tracing my footsteps just a few minutes later. "Are you two doing this on purpose?" I fling at Skyle, but there's nothing. I debate bringing more shadows around me, shielding so she won't know I'm here. But another part of me wants to see her again, is desperate to get answers. And with heat still smoldering inside me, I do the dishonorable thing for once. I do nothing. She stumbles out into the snow, tipping her head back like a kid seeing it for the first time. I watch tiny flakes of snow fall around her in a blur. She looks like an angel, her cloak blowing out in the wind behind her, her braid loose down her back. I stare at her greedily, drinking in her flushed cheeks and wide eyes as she stares up at the sky. Suddenly, as if realizing she's not alone, she whirls to look straight at me. Our eyes lock. "Is that churum?" she says accusingly. I dramatically inhale and blow out a long puff of smoke, savoring the warm air, the sweet smell, and the growing look of shock on her face. "Want some?" I gesture the roll towards her, not moving from the wall. "If she wants it, come and get it. Unless you want to continue our earlier argument, in which case, none for you." She looks so adorable in her outrage. "No," she says, her jaw dropping. "We're not allowed to smoke that." I keep my eyes on her as I take another long drag. "Yeah, well, the people that made that rule obviously weren't bonded to Skyle and Tern. Now were they?" I smirk, knowing she's feeling exactly what I'm feeling if she's out here too. For once, we're in entirely the same position. "It helps with distancing yourself." I gesture again for her to come closer. beyond what shielding does, of course. She shakes her head but comes toward me anyway, leaning back against the wall just beside me with a sigh. If I stretched a hand out just a few more inches, it would brush against hers. "Suit yourself," I say, taking a final long drag before extinguishing it against the rough bricks behind me. There's a long silence, where all I can hear is her short, rapid breathing. Then she says, like she's admitting a secret to the darkness, "I feel like I'm on fucking fire." It's such a perfect description for how I feel when I'm near her that I laugh. Yeah, that happens. It feels evil to enjoy this, when I know these emotions aren't her own. But I'm so grateful she feels what I feel for once. I can't keep the smile off my face. I sense her watching me and slide my eyes over to lock with hers. She's staring at me with the same heated, angry eyes from earlier on the mat. Only this time they are blazing. I know that look. "Oh, violence," I tease. "You're going to have to learn shield against Tan or his escapades with scale will drive you mad." I can't look at her gazing at me like that. So I lean my head back against the wall and close my eyes as I add, "Or into someone's bed." "Oh, I know," she says, her voice breathless. "I am horrified to see Liam again." My eyes spring open. "Liam? Why?" What happened between them? I can feel my heartbeat in my throat as I add with a casualness I don't feel, "Where is your bodyguard anyway?" "I'm my own bodyguard," she flings back, her head twisting to rest her cheek on the stone so she's facing me, eyes shutting against the insistent pounding of heat I know she must feel just like I do. "And he's in bed." "Your bed?" I demand furiously, shadows whipping out from me uselessly into the night. "Liam would never," the rational part of me protests. But I'm paranoid and jealous and burning with emotions that aren't mine. I don't care how it sounds. "No," she says, and I feel like I can breathe again. "Not that it should matter to you." She's looking at me with a puzzled expression. "It doesn't matter to me," I say, forcing boredom into my tone. Like she can't see straight through me anyway. "As long as you're both consenting, and believe me, you're in no condition to consent. You have no idea what I'm capable of consenting." I feel a surge of heat behind my shields that powers my imagination anyway. I see her legs wrapped around me, her fingers in my hair, and... nope, not happening. I pour my shadows into my mental shield against Skyle, reinforcing whatever distance I can muster. Without warning, Violet pitches forward, her knees going out underneath her, and I grab her instinctively, hands and shadows whipping out to catch her round her waist. The second I touch her... oh, gods. She's not just feeling what I'm feeling. This is on an entirely different level. Her skin practically burns me through her leathers, and I can almost sense hot, raw power sparking off her in urgent, pulsing waves. "Why the hell aren't you shielding?" It's difficult to keep my hands on her like this, and it takes far too much strength to steel myself and keep her upright. "Not all of us have been given lessons," she hisses back, a few inches from my face. "He just started channeling before all this. And in case you forgot, you're only allowed to attend Professor Carr's class when you can wield. Always thought that was a ridiculous rule." I sigh, trying not to feel her hands wrapped around my shoulders. "All right, crash course. Only because I've been where you are and woken up with more than a few regrets. And I really don't want to be one of yours. You're actually going to help me?" That pisses me off. Does she think I frequently go around intervening during threshing, warding first year's bedroom doors and accusing wing leaders of treason? "I've been helping you for months," I say through gritted teeth, my hands flexing at her waist. "No," she seems genuinely confused. "You sent Liam to help. He's been helping me for months. Well, weeks. Almost months. Whatever." The way she says his name sends a pang of jealousy through me, and I plaster a mask of great offense on my features so she can't see it. "I'm the one who burst through your door and killed everyone who attacked you, and then I removed the other threat to your life with a very public, very polarizing display of vengeance. Liam didn't do that. I did. The crowd wasn't polarized. They were all for it. I was there. You were torn. In fact, you begged Tern not to kill her, damn well knowing she'd just come after you again.
Fine, she shrugs. But let's not pretend you didn't do most of that for yourself. It would be inconvenient for you if I died. I can't believe she still thinks that is what this is all about. Guess all it takes is a few weeks of pretending I'm a selfish asshole, looking out for his own skin. But I thought it was fucking obvious that I can't seem to stay away from her. How I can't stop myself from intervening in every little thing she does. I stare at her in disbelief, shaking my head. I am so done rehashing this same argument.
You know what? We're not fighting tonight. Not if you want to learn how to shield.
Fine. We're not fighting. Teach me.
She tilts her chin up at me in challenge. My hand still wrapped around her, I lean in closer to meet the challenge in her eyes.
Ask me nicely, I say silkily. Have you always been this tall?
She asks disarmingly.
No, I was a child at some point.
She won't win this challenge with me either. Ask me nicely, Violence, I whisper, or I'm gone. I'm so wrapped up in her, I wouldn't leave if the world was on fire.
How often is it like this with them?
She deflects again. Often enough that you're going to need proper shields, I parry back. You won't ever be able to block them out completely, and sometimes they forget to block us, like tonight. I still have my suspicions about that. That's why the Churum helps, but at least it's like walking by a brothel instead of actively participating in one. Her eyes blaze in understanding. Right then. All right. Will you teach me to shield? I smile at her, knowing she needs me just as much as I need her for once. Say please. My gaze drops to her lips before I can help myself, determined to hear those words from her.
Are you always this difficult?
Only when I know I have something you need. What can I say? I like making you squirm. Gods, I'm enjoying this far too much. After every look she's given me, every challenge sparking in her eyes that I feel racing up my spine,
it's like a sweet little slice of payback for what you've put me through these last couple of months.
Snowflakes have settled on her hair, little icy shards peppering through the braid that frames her face. I reach out and brush them away, like she's mine. What I've put you through.
Shit.
I try to take back the words. You've scared me nearly to death once or twice, so I think saying please is a fair request. She glares at me and takes a deep, steadying breath. As you prefer.
Xaden?
I can already tell from her tone and her sweet little smile that she's going to make me suffer just as much. She inches closer to me.
Would you pretty, pretty please teach me how to shield before I accidentally climb you like a tree and we both wake up with regrets?
Oh, she's good. But I'm better. I smile back at her, knowingly.
Oh. I'm firmly in control of my faculties.
A shadow strokes down her arm, feather light, barely touching. I know I'm balancing on an edge, a wafer-thin line between control and freefall, but it feels right being here with her.
And since you ask so nicely,
I croon back at her, my hands lifting to slide along her cheeks, wrapping back to cup her head in my hands, angling her eyes up at me. She stares at me, her eyes burning.
Close your eyes, I whisper.
It requires touching me.
Her voice is shaky.
Not at all. Just one of the perks of not thinking too clearly. You have incredibly touchable skin. It makes my heart pound to just say it. No double meaning, no ulterior motives, just the truth. You need to envision somewhere, anywhere. I guide her, my eyes closing as hers do, and my own mind already centering myself in Aretia, working through the steps that have become as natural as breathing.
I prefer the top of my favorite hillside near what's left of Aretia. Wherever it is, it needs to feel like home.
I picture her standing there with me, looking out over the soft curves of greenery in every direction.
Feel your feet hit the ground and dig in some, I tell her.
Got it.
Her voice is quiet but determined, and my eyes blink open to look at her. That's called grounding, keeping your mental self somewhere so you aren't swept away by the power. Her eyelids flutter in concentration, her brow furrowed. It feels so intensely intimate to be so close to her, my hands on her, and her eyes shut tight, trusting me. Now call to your power. Open your senses. Her body reacts to the picture she's forming in her mind, her fingers twitching and muscles tensing. Too much, she says, the warmth of her breath caressing my face. Focus on your feet. Stay grounded. Can you see where the power flows from? If not, just pick a place. I'm so focused on her, shadows crowding out everything else around us, narrowing my field of vision so she's all I can see. I watch her eyes squeeze tight, her breaths coming deep and heavy, her chest rising. You can do this, Violet. I've got you. I see it, she says, surprised at herself. Perfect. You're a natural. My tone is even, despite the pride bursting in my chest. It takes most people a week just to learn how to ground. Now do whatever you need to mentally do to wall yourself off from that current. Tern is the source. You block that power, and you'll have some control back. I feel a blast of heat through my own bond with Skyle, the same time as it's fired back at me through the contact with Violet and through her. Tern. The intensity of it takes my breath away, and I grit my teeth to keep still and steady, willing her to keep her focus. Her hands cling onto my arms like I'm the only thing keeping her standing. You've got this, I say for myself as much as for her. Whatever you create in your mind is real to you. Shut off the valve, build a wall, whatever makes sense. I'm mentally reinforcing my own shields as I talk her through it. It's a door, she says, her fingers fisting in my shirt. A glimpse of a heavy, antique, shield-like door flashes through my mind, and I push it back towards her. This is hers. I'm determined that she has somewhere that is her own, in a world full of us and ours. There you go! Keep going, I urge, steeling my voice against the utter disbelief that she's doing this on day one. Her hands tremble against me, her muscles squeezed tight. I've got the door shut. Unbelievable. Great. Lock it. She physically sags against me, letting out a long-held breath. It changed. I can see through the door. Her voice is full of wonder and delight, her head moving like she can see it in front of her with her eyes still shut tight. Well, fuck. Yeah. You'll never be able to fully block him. Got it locked? She nods. Open your eyes, but do your best to keep that door locked. It means keeping one foot grounded. I think back to my first few months learning, when the intensity of Scale's power would roar through whatever shadows I could muster and add. Don't be surprised if it slips. We'll just start again. I want her to know how strong she is, how capable, no matter what comes next. She blinks open her eyes, looking straight at me. I wait for Tern's power to take her back under, but there's nothing but the wind whipping snow all around us. She smiles at me and starts to say something. I can't believe she just did that. She made it look so easy. How is it that she constantly manages to surprise me? I can't take my eyes off her, studying the way her smile spreads across her features, how her eyes sparkle with joy. You are... I realize I don't have the words. Astonishing, I finish uselessly. Her smile widens and it feels like a jolt in my chest. I shake my head. I couldn't do that for weeks, I admit, fully expecting her to use it against me. But she doesn't. There's no mockery in her voice. It's soft and breathy as she says, "Guess I have a superior teacher." I don't even realize I'm touching her. It feels like a habit between lovers of years. My thumbs are making idle circles by her ears, stroking her soft, beautiful skin. I risk a glance at her lips, and it feels so natural to lean in and kiss her. My hands move her head towards mine like muscle memory. A torturous heat blazes through me, and I let her go like she's burned me, backing up a few steps. Damn it! Touching you was a bad idea, but my eyes are glued to her. The worst, she agrees, as her tongue skims across her lower lip, and I can't help but groan at the sight of it, wanting so desperately to close the space between us. Kissing you would be a cataclysmic mistake. One of us needs to stop this. This is only going to end one way. Calamitous, she agrees, but her tone doesn't match her words. We'll both regret it. I'm not strong enough to stop this. Say no, Violet. Naturally, she whispers, her eyes locking with mine in a challenge. That final look does it. Fuck it. I stride forwards 2 paces and grab her towards me, my mouth finally on hers. At first, it's all heat and fire. The idea alone that I'm finally kissing her scorching through me, incinerating every reason to fight against this. In less than a heartbeat, I have her pressed up against the stone wall, and she's kissing me back feverishly like she never wants it to stop. I want to touch her everywhere. I rake my hands through her hair, angling her head up to kiss her deeper, sliding my tongue into her mouth. Her hands are all over me, running over my chest and back, gripping at my shirt to pull my body closer to her, to pin her harder against the wall. She seems to melt into me, softening to let me touch every part of her. My heartbeat thunders in my chest at the feel of her like this, desire pounding through my veins in heavy pulses. I can't get enough of her. I kiss her deeply, savoring the taste of her, the way her tongue pushes back against mine, the press of her lips. I feel like she's breaking me, cracking through the last shreds of self-control I have left. Violence. I can't help but groan it against her lips, closer, closer. I can't tell if it's my thought or hers, I just pull her harder against me, recklessly seeking out every part of her. I want her wrapped around me, under me, on top of me, everywhere. My hands trail down the curve of her back, skimming the knots and laces, tracing the memory of revealing her back from her corset inch by inch, just a few weeks ago in her room. But this time, I don't stop myself. I keep moving, my hands gripping her ass and lifting her up, wordlessly inviting her to wrap her legs around my waist, pressing her up higher against the wall as her thighs squeeze my hips. We're face to face now, and her hands fist into my hair and palm my cheeks, our mouths sliding against each other. More, more. God's the way she wants me. It feels like she's holding my heart in her fist, squeezing tight. I want her just as badly. My hips rock into hers of their own volition, pressing myself against her even harder. She gasps, and the sound echoes through me. I break the kiss to look at her, her eyes and hair wild, lost in me, in this. I kiss along her jaw, her neck, greedily seeking out any and every part of her I haven't tasted. She moans into me, her hands and nails and mouth all over me, her thighs squeezing tight around my waist. A blinding flash of white light bursts around us like a warning, and I feel my shadows skitter and miss a beat at the answering boom of thunder. What the hell? Was that? It's like a jolt to my system, resetting my conscience, and I push back, panicked. What the hell are we doing? I have completely lost control and her eyes are locked on mine, panting in long drawn-out breaths as I step back from her, setting her down on the ground. What have I done? How did I let this get so completely out of control? It's her first day channeling, the first time she's been bombarded with the emotions of Tern and Skyle, and I just... Nausea threatens to overwhelm me. It took me months to control myself against that onslaught of power and feeling. This isn't real. This isn't her. She doesn't want this. I back up a few steps, without taking my eyes from her, almost choking on the intensity of how far I've betrayed her. But my pulse still echoes through me as I bite out, "You have to go." "Why?" Her voice is breathless, lust and want so clear on her face. The snow falls in light clumps around her, the wind tugging at her hair. "This isn't real. This isn't her," I tell myself again. "Because I can't," I say. "Focus on what's real. Feel the ground beneath your feet. Dig in. Put your hands behind your head. Visualize." I try and center myself, grounding like a first year. And I refuse to act on a desire that isn't yours. So you have to walk back up those steps. Now. She stares at me, eyes wide and burning with heat. But I want... This isn't your want. I am so unjustly furious at Tern and Skyle, I want to scream it at the sky. But I did this, not them. That's the fucking problem. And I can't leave you out here on your own. So have just a little mercy on me and go. I feel like my heart is breaking. This isn't real. I watch the realization at what I almost let happen dawn in her eyes, and she just nods and runs. My shadows race after her, like they don't want to let her go. Cloaking myself in the darkness, I sink down onto my knees and put my hands in the icy gravel, squeezing, feeling the sharp shards of stone bite into my skin. This isn't real, I think over and over. Except that it still feels real to me. Thank you all for watching. Let me know what you thought in the comments. I tried adding background music and some sound effect. Yay or nay? Let me know.